we gave voice to our students. Would you believe that all the rules and regulations which are made for the classroom or for anything else, the student body is a part of it. So they write the consequences also if we break the rules. The traditional education system on which we were, you know, working for such a long time, who gave that system? The Britishers. They wanted people who cannot think, right? They wanted people who can actually serve them, kind of slaves. This is what they wanted. And the base of NEP says that we should move from rote learning towards the competency-based, towards the higher levels of Bloom.
Welcome to the Learning Circle, the ultimate video podcast for educators and parents who want to unleash the full potential of children. Join us as we explore the fascinating world of learning with the help of thought leaders who will share their knowledge and stories with us. This is your host, Kavleen Kaur, and I'm excited to take you on this journey. Get ready to be inspired, informed, and entertained.
Hello and welcome to the Learning Circle. Today, we have the immense honor of hosting Dr. Vandana Shahi, a distinguished leader in the field of education. She currently serves as a senior principal at BCM School, Ludhiana. Dr. Shahi is a lifelong learner and a recognized trainer. In recognition of her outstanding contributions to education, she received the National Award to Teachers in the year 2022 from the Honorable President of India. She has also been honored with numerous other accolades, including the BrainFeed Lifetime Achievement Award, Global Principals Award, Progressive Principal of India by Rethink India Foundation, Rajiv Gandhi Excellency Award, and many more. Dr. Shahi's dedication to education extends beyond the classroom. She is also the founder member of the Aagas Charitable Foundation in Ludhiana, and serves on the advisory board of several educational organizations. She serves as the district training coordinator and master trainer. So she is the best expert for today's discussion on teacher training and professional development under NEP. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Vandana Shahi to the Learning Circle.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Kavli.
Yes, it's an honor to host you, ma'am.
The pleasure is mine.
Okay, so ma'am, I'll start the discussion with the prestigious award you got, the National Award to Teachers. I would request you to share with us what this recognition means to you personally and professionally. And given your extensive experience of 30 years in the field of education, what aspects of your philosophy and approach do you believe were recognized by this award?
Okay. Talking about personally, first of all, I would say this is one of the greatest blessings of my life. Because receiving such a big award, such a prestigious award, and that too from the President of India, it's a great achievement. In fact, Kavleen, I did my MSc and I was the topper of the university. And then I did my PhD, which was fully funded by UGC. And there were many people who used to ask me why school after doing PhD and doing MSc with such good grades. Sometimes even I used to be in doubt. But this award has put a full stop to all those doubts which I had, that maybe God had this plan for me, and I'm really, really grateful to God for that. Having said that, I would say when I was there on the stage to receive the award, what I found in my mind, I was finding many people walking with me. Because such a big award is never an award of one person. That is not possible. You know, my highly progressive and supportive management, the BCM Foundation, everybody knows about that. And particularly, I would like to mention the president of our school, Shri Suresh Ji Munjal. You know, you ask for anything and he would ask just one thing. Is it good for the students? Just go ahead. You know, with such kind of environment, your encouragement is doubled. And then, the team is more productive. Talking about the team, very hardworking and dedicated staff without whom nothing is possible. self-driven students are there and very, very understanding parents. I could see all of them, and because this was the work of everybody, and this was the work of 20 long years, because I'm the founder principal of this school. So from that time we have been working. So I dedicate this award completely to all the stakeholders of this school. This is how I consider. Then your second question was why?
Yes.
Say that, as you know, that NEP, it came in 2020. And then I was fortunate enough that I was picked up as one of the master trainers. I got the opportunity to, train many principals and teachers from different states, right? So while I was doing that, at the same time, I could implement NEP, I mean, the baby steps, not the entire one, because the implement process had yet to come. It was the policy only that had come. So I started implementing it in my school. I gave free hand to my teachers. I told them to be, more and more innovative in their pedagogical practices. We gave voice to our students. Would you believe that all the rules and regulations which are made for the classroom or for anything else, the student body is a part of it. So they write the consequences also if we break the rules. So they became a part of it. And there's one more thing which was very important, that was we started with the awareness of sustainable development goals very early, when the people even didn't know about that. So we were working for that. So probably all these efforts were there which had actually fetched this award. But at the same time, I would say yes, it has increased our responsibility, because what we think that this award has shown us that we are on the right path.
Yes,
we have to be we have to work harder for that reason.
Yes. That's a beautiful explanation there, ma'am, of the award and the role of the various people who were there with you in this journey, including surprisingly the students as well. And I really like the idea of students creating the rule themselves and then facing the consequences of breaking them.
So it's easier for them than to face, because we don't call them as punishments. We don't punish our children. So sometimes, the consequences are like excellent, which again lead to the growth of the child. Like if you're not listening properly, so then you have to write a note, you have to write a letter, you have to write something, which again, it's not a kind of punishment ki ghar ke bahar khade, school ke bahar class mein khade ho jao. Nothing like that. It's like, something which is good for them.
Yes, and this is aligned with the NEP's guideline of creating 21st century skills in the students as well. And you talked about being a master trainer even before the NEP implementation formally came into place. So that sets the tone for today's topic of teachers training for NEP. So share your views on why a revamp to the teachers training is required with the NEP implementation starting. So why is it necessary? We always had these teacher training sessions, the professional development sessions. So what is the revamp here and why is it needed?
So I'll talk about why part first of all. The traditional education system on which we were working for such a long time, who gave that system? The Britishers?
Yes.
What did they want? They wanted job seekers. They wanted people who cannot think, right? They wanted people who can actually serve them, kind of slaves. This is what they wanted. And unfortunately, after so many years of independence also, almost the same kind of systems, of course, policies came. But, there was not a very big change, I would say. But the society has changed. Our nation is now, moving ahead with a vision. So that is how, schools are not the islands in the society. From the education system also, there are some expectations of the society. Like now they want the creators. Now they want the critical thinkers. Now they want that the products of the schools should be the ones who can solve the problems, who are the decision makers. Right. And NEP is a very, very futuristic document. It talks about, it actually talks about making the students all this what I'm talking about. What about the teachers? They are the product of the traditional system. So they are not aware, you know, what we have to teach to our students now. They are not actually aware of that, ki which kind of changes they should be doing. So that is why this, you know, training, it becomes very, very important. Training, as you said, it was always important because, you know, changes definitely changes the law of the nature. It always happens. But the thing is, like now, because the changes are very, very fast, and especially talking about technology, our children are digital natives. We are digital migrants. So first of all, you know, the first thing that we need to know is to keep pace with the our children only. So that is how, and that is why the trainings became very, very important. And if you see that there's maximum emphasis which is given for the capacity building of the teachers, and not only that, for the principals also to lead the teaching and learning process entirely. So this is how, yes, of course, it is to achieve rest of the goals of NEP. The first part, the most important part, is to build the capacity of the teachers.
Right, right. And you touched very important points that, you know, training has already always been there, like I said, and also the change has always been there, but the change is now very fast and very huge. You know, every decade, there is a lot of, you know, change happening. And the teachers have to have the capacity to enable the children to cope up with that change. So that will happen only when they themselves are able to cope up. So like you said, you know, from digital migrants, we educators also become digital natives. So yes, be in sync with technology, being in sync with the requirements of the changing time is necessary. So that very well establishes the why of the revamp required in the teacher's training. Now let us come to the what part. What has changed? What are the skills that NEP suggests that teachers should develop? And what are the expected outcomes of implementing these new trainings and professional development strategies for the teachers?
See, Gavleen, if we talk about the entire educational process, it has got three elements, three most important elements: curriculum, pedagogy, and assessment. Right? Now, when the policy came, it had come with very, very clear-cut guidelines, which is for the entire nation, not only for CBSE or for one board. It is, you know, it's come from the Ministry of Education.
Right.
On the basis of that policy, the national curriculum framework is written. A complete framework is given, a structured process is given. The most important thing is that a lot of care has been taken to the developmental stages of the child. You know, it's very, very scientific. This time the policy that has come, it is this 5 plus 3 plus 3 plus 4 system. It is not just like the 10 plus 2 system. It has taken into account all these stages of development. So when we talk about the structured NCF, it has taken everything from the NEP, and the base of NEP says that we should move from rote learning towards the competency-based learning, towards the higher levels of Bloom. So, and earlier we were working towards the lower levels of Bloom. Now it is more emphasis is towards analyzing, towards application, towards creativity, right? So we have to move towards that. So if we have to do that, how would we do that? It is the how part comes in the pedagogy. How do we teach the educational approach, the curriculum? If it is friction, if it is gravitation, if it is photosynthesis, it is not going to change. The content will remain the same. What will change? The pedagogy. Our approach to the curriculum would change. And it should be active. It should be child-centered. The most important thing is it should be child-centered. Earlier, what used to be there? Teacher is the main focus. Now, child is the main focus. On the other hand, the teacher should not be just like a sage on the stage. Has to be a guide by the side of the teacher. So active learning, collaborative learning, experiential learning, research-based learning. Now, all these learnings which I'm talking about, all these methods of learning which I'm talking about, just think, everywhere the child is there in the center. If the child is not owning the learning, owning his own learning, the child is not becoming, cannot depend on the teacher completely. If we are teaching in this way, the child has to think. So that is how they will become the critical thinkers. So the entire pedagogy should be changed. Then whether the learning has taken place or not, whether the outcomes, the learning outcomes or the competencies which we wanted, whether the children have achieved them or not, for that the assessment will have to change. So as per NEP, the training for the teachers is required in all the domains. All the domains, when I talk about all the domains, not only the cognitive domain, in fact, it should take into account the affective and psychomotor domain also, right?
Right.
So that is why, you know, the trainings which are being done, they are being done keeping in mind the pedagogy, most importantly, how do they approach the curriculum, and then how do they assess the assessment part.
Right. So you mentioned that out of these three aspects of teaching, curriculum, pedagogy and assessment, the pedagogy and assessments, they have revamped based on the requirements of the 21st century. And the teachers need to be trained because their original training has not been based on the NEP recommendation. So that is why the training is necessary. And the training covers these two aspects of teaching and learning across all the domains that you mentioned.
Because the curriculum actually has come from the framework only. It is coming from there. So approach to the curriculum that needs to be, teachers need to be trained for that.
Right, right. And like you said, it has to be child-centric. So that is a very big mind shift from the traditional teaching that we have always had. So this focus on child taking the center stage, every child, every student taking the center stage requires a mind shift within the teaching community, in fact, across the educational sector. So this, I hope the training also covers this particular aspect.
100%, 100%, that particular aspect, because, you know, that is why I said all the kind of innovative pedagogies which are coming. So everywhere, child is there in the center, child is engaged, is not only involved that is forced to do something, is engaged properly. So, you know, again, the teachers will have to learn about that. How can I take, which kind of activities I can take to the class, which kind of, even if it is the gamification of learning, some game is being played, has to have a learning outcome.
Right, right. And you shared at the beginning of the session, you shared a very good example of students creating the rules themselves. So then owning those rules becomes their responsibility, you know. So there we have one example of this child-centric, student-centric approach actually being implemented.
Exactly.
So with training, teachers would learn of several such use cases which they can implement in their classrooms, right? Ma'am, that brings us to the next question. How can teachers assess the training and professional development opportunities which are provided under NEP? And how are the training programs tailored to the need of the teachers at different stages of their careers?
Yeah. See, first of all, I think you might be knowing that NEP has made it mandatory that minimum 50 hours of training every teacher should go through. And I think 50 hours is also less and they should do even more. And they have made it very, very convenient because the training is being given online as well as offline. So when you talk about online, sitting at home, you can get the training. The platforms are Diksha, the platform is Nishtha, which is from Ministry of Education. Then there are many, many MOOC platforms where you find a lot of material. And you know which kind of trainings are there? Every teacher should know about them. They have some videos about the content so that you don't get bored. First of all, you yourself see it from the video. Then they have the text also for the deeper learning. Then they have the assessment, whether actually you have learned that concept or not, and then only the certification would be there. This is about the online training. talking about the offline trainings. Now, I am from CBSE, so I'll talk about CBSE. Every regional center has a center of excellence, COEs. Now, this center of excellence is actually meant for the trainings, and they have appointed district training coordinators in every district, like as you said, for the Ludhiana district, I'm the district training coordinator also. So, in different schools, they make full calendars for the entire year. Different schools, different kinds of trainings are taking place, which are generic as well as subject specific. Like learning outcomes and pedagogies, critical and creative thinking, active learning, collaborative learning, and social emotional learning, experiential learning. So these are all the generic topics which every teacher should know. And you can register yourself. There is an online portal for training. You register there and then you can go and attend the training. The other trainings are subject specific training. For example, I'm talking about mathematics. If I talk about mathematics, so there would be through the activities, innovative pedagogies would be told. Then it is stage wise that if you have to teach maths to elementary classes, how it should be taught. If you have to teach maths to middle classes, how it should be taught. And if it is for the senior, because pedagogy also changes, because when you are there in the lower classes, in the junior classes, it has to be activity based, more and more play based. But as you progress, some deeper learning is also required, right? So the depth of knowledge is also required. So accordingly, the trainings have been tailor made. And there is another very important aspect of these training, that they have these need based trainings also. In my school, for example, I identify the need of my teachers. I send them a Google form. I send them that these are the kind of trainings which I think we should do. What do you think? Tick mark two trainings. So wherever you get the maximum score, you just write to COE. They will do it specifically for your school. So, which is something which is very, very good. So, this is how for the trainings, a lot of importance is being given from the CBSE side.
Right. And quite a few points you shared. I would like to spend a bit more time on this, because the how part is important for teachers. Although I think in our show notes, we will also give in some resources. I would request you to share some resources. Which we can pass to the teachers. But just to, reiterate, you talked about the need-based training, wherein a school can choose the trainings that they want and write to COE, and COE will help get those trainings.
Completely different tab, different portal for that if you want to do it for your own school.
Right. So that is a good point to know, this for the schools. And another is that there are both online and offline trainings where the teachers can themselves go and attend. So is there, for the online training, let's talk about that first. So is there a particular path that the teachers should take? What do you recommend? Is it a very self-explanatory kind of a path that NEP recommends for the teachers to take? Or it is up to the judgment of teachers, how, in what order, or, what, of course, there are subject specific skills subject teachers will take. But I also, like you said, there are some skills which all teachers should have. And those are related to what are called life skills or 21st century skills. So what do you recommend, a particular order or a methodology of how teachers should go about skilling themselves using these online platforms?
See, there is one thing which the most beautiful that NEP has done about the teachers also. They say that the teachers should be, first of all, self-aware, and they should be able to take the feedback from others also, from the peer, from the leaders, or from their community, which, I mean, teachers have made the communities also. Now, when the teacher is self-aware, or the teacher is talking to the other teachers in the staff room or somewhere, gets to know about strengths and weaknesses, right? So depending on that, if I know that these are the points, this socio-emotional learning is a point where I think I'm lacking. Knowing about more and more innovative pedagogies, particularly about science, that is a point where I'm lacking. So first of all, the way I'm saying that the schools should do their need analysis, same way the teachers should do their own analysis. That these are, because this is what I'm talking about. You talked about this, their self-learning. So then, you know, the modules, as I have already told you, whether they go to Diksha, they go to Nishta or any other platform, the modules are so self-explanatory that you don't need a teacher. You don't need, because there is a teacher in the video.
Yes.
She's explaining it very, very, very well, and with the help of some presentation. Then there is a text also. If you have some problems, you have some issues, you can discuss with the collaboration. This is something, you know, again, is talked about a lot. So you can talk to your friends about that if you're not able to understand. And then assessment tells you about yourself that, yes, you have understood, or you won't go through this particular module once again. So this is how the teachers, I think, should approach the trainings if they want to do it themselves, or for they can contribute to the school also. When the need analysis is happening, they should also raise their voice that these are the points, I mean, these are the kind of trainings which we would like to do.
Right. So that is a very useful point there, that the teachers should start with self-assessment of their skills, identify the training needs that they have, and then either go online and do a self training, or even raise it to the school, which can then approach the COE to conduct those trainings. And I think the COE would conduct the in-person, the offline trainings for these needs.
Offline trainings also, and on from COE side only, some online trainings are also done. And the good thing is that the online trainings are mostly free.
Yes. So there is actually, nothing stopping us educators from reskilling ourselves. It is just like you said, it has to start from self-awareness, self-assessment. You know, we have to be open to identify where we are lacking, what skills we should build, and then start from there.
And I think the most important skill that every teacher should have is that lifelong learning should be there in their mind, that we should keep learning.
We should keep learning, right. And then that will make all the educators be in sync with the changing times.
Exactly.
And we all would also become the digital natives, as you said. I really liked that comparison of the children being digital natives. Yes, they are. You know, they don't need to be taught technology, but they need to be taught the other life skills, wherein the teachers play a very, very critical role. Another question related to training is that there are these modules available online. There are offline trainings. Are there any communities also which teachers can join, post their queries, see what the others are posting, what others are learning, how are there some repository of lesson plans that they can take up?
See, when we talk about technology, we always talk about the good points and the bad points of technology, use and misuse of technology. So this is the use of technology that you are talking about. N number of communities are there. I mean, where very, very informative, you'll get the information about good trainings also. At the same time, a teacher sitting in Ludhiana can collaborate with another teacher sitting in Kerala, with another one sitting in Manipur, talk about their cultural and local needs and all that, and bring it to their classroom also. So I would suggest all the teachers to become part of such communities, and very, very easily available communities are there. WhatsApp, normally we talk about WhatsApp University, but WhatsApp University does some good things also, particularly when such kind of communities are made. And you know, otherwise, I always say my teachers that you should always keep 3 R's with you. One is that you should keep reflecting on your practices. Another is you should research. So such kind of communities you will get only if you research. And third is always keep record, because that's very important. Learning from others is important. Learning from other platforms is important, but at the same time, what you have learned, if it is recorded, you can always get back to that.
Right. Those are 3 really critical R's, you know. We've talked about 3 C's and all, but these 3 R's are key in teachers skilling themselves. So yes, you know, recording is important because then they can always get back and do a spaced repetition for their own skills, and also when they want to implement in the class, they can bring out those lesson plans. But yes, of course, like you said, it has to start with the reflection, self-awareness, self-assessment to identify the needs, and then research the online platforms available, the communities available, the COEs are there, and learn the skills which are required. So yes, a lot of resources available out there. It is just a matter of picking up, you know, the right resources. And actually having, like we said, having that mind shift that, you know, we are also learners. And in order to be better teachers, we have to be better learners. That is how I always see it. And we have talked about technology also. So technology is sort of a empowering tool in this NEP implementation, in this journey of professional development for teachers. And, you know, I had a question on the 21st century skills. Does NEP focus on 21st century skills, and are the training, teachers training also focuses on them? But I think all through our discussion, we have been talking about various 21st century skills of critical thinking, problem solving, self-awareness, reflection, student-centric learning. So use of technology, digital literacy. So all these, I think I see that they are already built in these NEP trainings. And I think once the teachers access these resources for their own learning, they'll become more comfortable with technology. And I think that that is addressing one of the, you know, thing that I have seen in teachers who we did not have the privilege of getting the technology training when the teachers were themselves students. So, but by using these resources, they'll get comfortable with technology. They'll have a hang of it. They'll then they can even train their students on these technology skills. So we don't really need to have very specific technology sessions. Of course, they have their own value, but by using these resources also, the teachers see the value of technology. And I think by your answers, I see that you are very affectionate. You see the power in technology. So there is no fear. Teachers should not fear technology, because that's a very critical part of 21st century skills and NEP.
Yeah, as you said, that there are teachers and students, they are very, very fortunate. I remember when I did my PhD, I was shuttling from Pusa Institute to JNU to HAU for the research work. I mean, the kind of journals and the periodicals which were coming there, they were not coming in my university. So today, in your 6x3 inches gadget, the entire world libraries are there. So very lucky that way. So that's the power of technology.
That's the power. And like you said, you know, a teacher sitting in Ludhiana or Delhi can interact with a teacher sitting somewhere in Northeast or South of India or
international. Yeah.
Yeah, international also. So all these, we can bring about the good practices of just about any country. And we can also help the children become global citizens by helping them see the nuances of different places.
Exactly.
So, you know, we have discussed a lot about how teachers can skill themselves. Now, do you think the parents can also play a role in all this? The students are being trained on these skills at schools. The parents who may not necessarily have any exposure to these new learnings or trainings, how can they also contribute to their children's development?
I think undoubtedly you would agree with me, Kavleen, that parents are equal partners in the education of the child. And these days, you know, they have left a lot of parenting on us. So we have become equal partners in bringing up the child also. So, but they always were the partners in the educational journey of, and yes, as you said, that everybody is not expert. No problem. It's okay, the teachers, they are sending them to the school definitely for the core academic skills, and the teachers are expert, they are doing it. But the continuity of the learning, that is very important at home. It is not like that whatever that the child has done in the school would be sufficient, because we have very clearly seen the children of the parents who are engaged with the school and the of the parents who are totally disengaged, there's a lot of difference in that performance. And it is not necessary that, you know, you should know the subject. Even if you, every day, you just ask the child, first of all, give the congenial environment. That's the most important thing, because that is also important for the child's learning. So every day, just ask what happened in the school. What did you like? What did you actually do good? Ask them, not just what did you learn today? That's not very important for them. Rather, did you do some good deed? I seriously feel one thing, that our parents these days, they need to be the role models in teaching the fundamental duties to the students. That is something which is actually required. And I'm always reminded of a scene from a movie, Ferrari Ki Sawari, where, you know, this hero, he was going on scooter and his son is sitting at the back, and somehow he jumps a red light. And there was no traffic controller over there. And on the next light, he goes searching for that traffic person. And when he finds one, and he says, ki, bhaiya, mera chalan kaat do. And he says, why it didn't happen there? He said, because there was nobody. He said, then why are you doing so? Nobody has seen you. He said, my son has seen me. So, you know, such a great message for being the role model. Actually, we, the parents, we are not making them, we are not helping them in becoming the good citizens. I would say, see, the child until the age of around 6 or 7 is very, very innocent and would speak the truth. But slowly, you know, goes down. So it's not, learning is not, again, I am coming to the same point. It is not only in the cognitive domain, it is in the affective domain, it is there in the psychomotor domain. So teach them the values, the moral values. Teach them the value of health and hygiene. Teach them the value of outdoor games. CBSE has come up with a very good document for the parents, home-based learning. Its name is home-based learning. It is available on the CBSE website. So they can take it out, and it tells about all those, you know, things which the parents can do for the children. You know, which kind of congenial, sometimes, you know, the parents would think that this is something which I'm doing good for the child, but ultimately, you know, it's very, very bad. Like a lot has been said about the instant gratification. We cannot say no to the child. We don't say no to the child. Ask for something, we just give to them. But you know what happens, because of this reason, the child is not able to listen to no.
Yes,
in the life there would be many no's, and failure also we call it as a no. I mean, you wanted something, you didn't get it. That is what the failure is. And if they don't understand the failure, you know, that teaches you most.
Exactly, yes.
Failures are stepping stones.
And the children have to be taught that. They have to learn that.
They need to know that the failures are bound to happen, how to accept those failures, and we want to make them resilient. That's the most important thing, that if they fall, they are able to get up. So these are certain things, I mean, not certain things, many things actually. The child is a holistic individual. Only the brain, only the cognitive aspect is not everything. His values, his dispositions, his behaviors, his health, everything matter. So there, everything is education. So in all those domains, I think the parents are the one who can do more than what the schools can do.
Right. So that's really very powerful, ma'am. And you know, you created a very clear boundary between the cognitive skills which the school is taking care of, definitely, and they have the competency for that. The teachers have the competency. So we can leave that part to the teachers. But the parents have a very, very important responsibility, and that is to be role model, to be responsible citizens themselves and help the children create values. And like you said, make them resilient by learning that failure is inevitable. The point is to fall and get up. That puts a lot of responsibility on the parents. But I think that is something which has always been there. It is like that, you know, we parents sometimes outsource these responsibilities. And, you know, I keep hearing parents saying, you know, zamana bahut kharab hai, you know, but it is like that. We still have to prepare. We can do that. Right. And you also pointed out the home-based learning, which NEP has released for the parents. So NEP actually is a very well thought of policy.
For all the stakeholders, actually.
For all the stakeholders, yes. And the beauty is that it is keeping the child, the student at the center. So we are actually taking care of our future generations. You know, we may have done some errors, some blunders, but this is NEP and its implementation is a chance to actually set things right, both as educators and as parents. Thank you very much for sharing these pointers, ma'am. And I think we have discussed about the theory a bit of NEP, what it recommends, but we have discussed about the various resources available, the communities which the educators can join, and also, you know, how the parents have to reflect. Again, it starts with reflection and implementation to help the children attain all these skills. And ma'am, any message for the students? I see you have a passion of a, you know, true educationist. So I would really like you to share something for the students.
For the students, I would say that, as I've already said, children, you are very, very fortunate that you are born in an era where sky is the limit. We just used to say, just use that potential and look up to all those children who are at the age of, you know, 6, 7, 8, sometimes we get so surprised that what kind of wonders they are doing. So every child has got the same potential, maybe in different direction. Please identify your potential and excel. God bless you all.
Okay, thank you for these blessings for all the students out there, ma'am. And thank you, Dr. Vandana, for sharing your valuable insights and experience with us today. Your contributions to education are truly inspiring. And to our listeners, we hope you found this discussion on teacher training and professional development under NEP really enlightening. And there are a lot of action items, takeaways that you can implement in your professional journey. And if you enjoyed this episode, I would request you to subscribe to our channel, The Learning Circle. Leave a review and also let us know about the topics you would like us to discuss. And also, if you have any questions for Dr. Vandana, please do share the questions with us. We'll forward it to ma'am and request her inputs and guidance on that. Thank you once again, ma'am, for giving us your time, coming on the channel.
The pleasure was all mine. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, ma'am.